I talk to companies all the time about the importance of branding, but rarely do I talk to an industry like yours at a time like this when branding couldn't be more critical. I'm not here to tell you the end is nigh or that telecom is dead. You've heard that all before. What I'm here to tell you is that all the doom and gloom you've been hearing about the channel should actually be seen as an opportunity. Fundamental industry shifts like the one you're experiencing are harbingers of opportunity. And one of the best ways to take advantage of that opportunity is with the power of branding. Today, we'll look at three fundamental elements of branding. We'll start by defining the basic concept of a brand. Next, we'll look at how branding has the power to influence customer behavior. And finally, we'll go over some of branding's benefits and the impact it has on your bottom line. I'm on a mission today to empower you with a better understanding of branding, to show you how to radically differentiate your brand, attract top talent, and command premium prices. Most importantly, I want you to take advantage of this monumental opportunity that's standing right in front of you. Sound good? Cool, let's get started. So, what is a brand? Brand is one of those words that is widely used but often misunderstood. Think about it. How would you define a brand? Some of you are probably thinking a brand is a company's name, like Verizon. Others of you may be thinking a brand is a company's logo, like AT&T's. But the truth is, neither of these things are the definition of a brand. And that's because brands aren't something you could point to, like a name or a logo. Brands live in the mind. They live in the minds of your customers, your employees, your investors, and everyone else they come into contact with. Simply put, brands are perceptions, and perception is a powerful thing. Take a second to think about your brand and how it makes you feel. Does it make you proud? Does it make you confident? Or does it make you cringe a little? The fact is, when it comes to your brand, you could do one of two things. You could pretend it doesn't exist and hope for the best, or you could acknowledge it, invest in it, and reap the rewards. I might be biased, but I tend to think the latter is the better course of action. Now let's get back to this idea of perception. There are two fundamental truths about perception that make branding so powerful. The first is, perceptions are reality. As far as our brains are concerned, there's no difference between what we perceive and what is real. The things we see, hear, and feel are really just electrical signals being interpreted by our brains. But we perceive them to be real because we must, in order to survive. The second truth is, perceptions are malleable. That is, they can be shaped. Our brains want the world around us to be rational and meaningful, so we unconsciously allow our perceptions to be influenced by external stimuli. Research has shown that the mere color of your logo could influence the way people perceive your company. For example, the color blue evokes feelings of confidence, trust, and reliability, whereas the color red inspires expertise and reliability. Branding, then, is the practice of shaping perceptions. And by shaping those perceptions, branding has the power to shape reality. The foundation of that reality is what's called the brand framework. The brand framework is a product of in-depth research and strategy and includes the fundamental elements of your brand. A comprehensive framework has 7 layers. At the center is your brand compass, which comprises core messaging components such as your purpose, vision, mission, and values. The next layer is your brand's positioning, which includes differentiating statements like your value propositions, competitive advantage, and brand promise. The third layer is your brand personality, which is a set of human characteristics expressed by your brand. It's defined by adjectives like intelligent, trustworthy, or even fun. Then comes your brand's name, which should relate to your audience on a deep and personal level. Naming extends from your company name to your products and services as well. After that comes your brand's visual identity, which is its face to the world. It includes your logo, color palette, fonts, photography, and so much more. Story, on the other hand, is the verbal language of your brand. It's expressed in the voice and messaging that bring your brand narrative to life. As you can see, there's a lot to consider when developing your brand. It's critical to define these elements before you spend the money and time creating the final layer of the brand framework, which is touchpoints. Touchpoints are the outward-facing facets of your brand that engage with the world. Your business cards, website, collateral, signage, the list goes on. They represent an opportunity for your audience to experience your brand and enhance an opportunity for you to shape their perceptions. Which brings us to another truth about perception. Perceptions dictate behavior. Research in social psychology has shown that while we may think we're in total control of our actions, our behavior is often influenced by stimuli we're completely unaware of. I'd like you to think about a time when you decided not to purchase a product or service. What brands come to mind? And please share a few examples. What was that? One more time? Lexus? Lexus? Kleenex. Kleenex, thank you. Anyone else? Anyone down here? Kentucky Fried Chicken. How about one more? Thank you. Taco Bell, a lot of food brands coming up today. Great. Well, these are examples of how brands could negatively influence purchasing behavior. And just because a brand was mentioned today doesn't mean that there's something inherently bad or wrong with the brand. It just means that certain people in the audience have had negative perceptions of that brand. So whether because of negative press, a poor customer experience, or just a lousy website, we tend to avoid wasting our money on brands that we perceive to be dodgy or inferior. Of course, the opposite is true for companies with strong brands. Now I'd like you to think about a time when you paid a premium for a product or service. What brands come to mind? Best Buy, thank you. Tesla, thank you. Rolex, thank you. GE, thank you. Any more? How about one more? Apple. I was looking for that one. Great. So these are examples of how we're willing to pay a premium for brands because we perceive them to be of high quality. The real difference between premium brands like Apple, which happens to be one of my favorites as well, is that they've purposefully built the idea of quality into their brand experience. Every single one of their touch points has been architected to evoke quality, from their products and packaging to their in-store experience. Over time, they've shaped customer perceptions, and in turn, their willingness to pay premium prices, even $1,000 for a mobile phone. As you can see, there's a lot at stake when it comes to how your brand is perceived. Unfortunately, too many companies see branding as just another marketing expense. So if there's one thing you take away from my talk today, is that branding is so much more than just a tactic. It's a long-term strategy that yields measurable returns throughout the life of your company. Let's now take a look at some of the returns that you'll get from your branding investment. Firstly, branding allows you to attract ideal customers. Central to any branding initiative is in-depth research, which allows you to precisely identify which types of customers are most valuable to your brand. Secondly, branding helps you to differentiate your business. It gives you an opportunity to define what your business does best and to own that competitive advantage in such a way that no other company can compete. Thirdly, branding enables you to close more deals. Ask any salesperson, and they will tell you, well-defined brands are just easier to sell. It's like the difference between trying to sell an old jalopy and a brand new BMW. Is there anyone in the audience who wouldn't want to command higher prices? I didn't think so. Branding enables you to position your company as an industry leader, allowing you to increase the prices for your products or services. Another benefit of branding is that it helps you to attract top talent, which is something you may not have considered. But the fact is, the best talent wants to work at the best brands. And finally, branding gives you the power to boost business value. The long-term benefit of branding is that your business itself becomes a more valuable asset when it's time to sell. As you can see, each of these benefits has a measurable impact on your bottom line. Add them all up, and the investment in branding can have truly exponential returns. In summary, you don't need me to tell you that the channel is experiencing a tectonic shift. Branding allows you to see this shift not as an omen, but as an opportunity. It enables you to reposition your company and influence customer behavior, resulting in a measurable impact to your bottom line. At the end of the day, branding gives you the power to shape the way the world perceives your company. And what could be a smarter investment than that? Thank you. I'd love to connect with you. I've put some of my contact information up here on the slide. You could take a photo of it if you're interested and reach out to me. We have our company website up there, ignitebrands.com. I encourage you to check it out. We have a ton of resources on branding on our website, many articles, rebranding guide, a checklist. It's all there. It's free to access, so definitely check that out. And you can also reach out to me directly at brian@ignitebrands.com or find me on Twitter. I'm very active on there, and I'm always giving away tips and tricks when it comes to branding and marketing. So thanks again. It's been a pleasure.